Aneurysms of the abdominal aorta occurring below the renal vessels should, in general, be replaced. This is particularly true if they are enlarging and producing pain or if there is evidence of impending or actual rupture in poor-risk patients with small aneurysms less than 5 cm in diameter. Observation may be the better course. Many aneurysms are corrected by endovascular techniques, but an open operative approach is acceptable and sometime necessary alternative. Although the operation is of considerable magnitude, anticipated mortality associated with spontaneous rupture and exsanguination from an aneurysm is such as to warrant the risk of surgery in the great majority of patients. Emergency operations may offer the only chance of a patient's survival if there is evidence of leakage or rupture of the aneurysm. A past history of coronary artery disease is not a contraindication to surgery. CT scan best defines the size and contour of these aneurysms. Transabdominal ultrasound is a good screening tool, but CT best defines size and proximal and distal extent. Aortography is carried out if there is a question about the extent of the aneurysm, if distal occlusive disease is present, and when renal vascular disease or mesenteric insufficiency is suspected. A thorough cardiac evaluation with an electrocardiogram, echocardiogram, and imaging stress test is performed in elective resection of an aneurysm. The preoperative preparation consists of emptying the large intestine by administering a mild cathartic. A fluid load of crystalloid is given at approximately 100 to 150 milliliters per hour beginning the evening before operation. Intravenous antibiotic coverage is started on call to the operating room. An nasogastric tube is inserted, and constant bladder drainage is initiated to follow accurately the hourly output of urine. Especially during the immediate postoperative period, catheters are placed for central venous and arterial monitoring. Wireless one-GANS catheter may be useful in complex cardiac cases. General anesthesia with intratracheal intubation is routine. The arterial line permits instantaneous evaluation of blood pressure changes, and blood gas sampling can be done when required. Several large bore, 16-gauge, catheters should be placed intravenously for adequate control of fluid and blood replacement. The patient is placed in a slight head-down position to aid in natural retraction of the small intestine from the region of the low abdomen. Intravenous catheters are secured in place in both arms and adequately protected from dislodgement. The urethral catheter is connected to a constant bladder drainage bottle. Since the presence of pulsations of the dorsalis pedis must be verified after the prosthesis has been inserted, some type of low support should be provided over the feet and lower third of the legs to assist in evaluating the presence of arterial pulsations. A long midline incision is made from xiphoid to pubis, figure 1. Many surgeons use a large open ring retractor for exposure. This retractor is secured to the side rail of the operating table and allows for the placement of multiple individual curved or angled adjustable retractors. After rapid palpation and visualization of the aorta and confirmation of the diagnosis of aneurysm, steps are taken to empty the abdominal cavity of small intestine. Unless the abdominal wall is quite thick, the greater portion of the small intestine can be retracted upward and to the right and inserted into a plastic bag, the mouth of which can be partly constricted by tape. Figure 2, saline is added to the plastic bag to keep the intestine moist. A sterile gauze pad is inserted into the neck of the plastic bag to avoid undue constriction and prevent the escape of the small intestine from the bag. It may be advisable, if the aneurysm is cissable and involves the right common iliac, to mobilize the appendix, terminal ileum, and cecum and to retract the right colon upward. The small and large bowels are retracted laterally and superiorly using multiple adjustable retractors. Additional exposure can be gained by dividing the peritoneum about the ligament of Dritz to permit further retraction of the small intestine upward and to the right. Figure 2, what at first may appear to be an inoperable aneurysm eventually may prove to be rather easily resectable, since the aneurysm tends to bulge anteriorly and seems to extend up so high as to suggest involvement of the renal vessels. Figure 3. The bulk of the aneurysm tends to come forward from under the left renal vein. The incised peritoneum over the anterior surface of the aneurysm is reflected by blunt and sharp dissection until the left renal vein is visualized. Blunt and sharp dissection frees the left renal vein from the underlying aorta. Figure 4. The left renal vein is retracted upward with a retractor. Figure 5. To gain additional space for the application of the occluding clamp to the aorta above the aneurysm, the left renal vein can be divided, if necessary, To gain a final exposure, it does not need to be re-anastomosed if the adrenal and gonadal vessel veins are intact. The inferior mesenteric artery is clamped. Figure 6. The aortic side may be divided and ligated from without or, conversely, oversewn from within after the aneurysm is opened. Usually, this vessel is small and sclerotic, in which case its sacrifice is of little consequence. In some instances, it is large and serves as a major contributor to the left colon blood supply, especially if internal iliac and mesenteric occlusive disease is present. In such cases, the vessel will be patent but will not exhibit back bleeding. Reimplantation of this vessel into the aortic graft may be required to protect the colon. The common iliac arteries then are exposed on their anterior, lateral, and medial surfaces in preparation for clamp placement. It is not necessary to encircle these vessels completely, and dissection posteriorly can result in troublesome hemorrhage from the underlying iliac vein during the iliac artery exposure. The ureters are identified and protected from injury throughout the procedure. Figure 6. In the past, certain grafts required pre-clotting. However, this is not necessary with woven grafts, knitted grafts sealed with collagen or gelatin, or expanded polytrifluoroethylene grafts. Heparin is then injected systemically or directly into the aneurysm to provide protective anticoagulation for the extremities during aortic clamping. Angled vascular clamps are applied to the distal common iliac arteries. An aortic clamp is used to occlude the aorta proximal to the aneurysm and distal to the renal arteries. A careful identification of the position of the renal arteries is mandatory before clamp application. The aneurysm is then opened through a linear arteriotomy. Figure 7, the mural thrombus is extracted. Figure 8, bleeding from the paired lumbar arteries is controlled with full thickness mattress or figure of 8 non-absorbable suture ligatures. Figure 9. The aortic cuff is next prepared by dividing all but the posterior wall. Leaving this portion attached prevents troublesome bleeding from lumbar veins often found in this area. Figure 10. The iliac arteries are prepared in similar fashion. The posterior wall is undisturbed to protect the iliac veins. Figure 10. Alternatively, some surgeons prefer to completely transect the proximal aorta and the distal iliac arteries so as to provide free circumferential cuffs for graft anastomosis. A graft of appropriate size is then stretched and tailored to fit the aortic defect. Figure 11, suturing of the graft begins in the midline posteriorly with a double arm swedged OO or OOO non-absorbable suture, usually made of monofilament nylon or polypropylene. The initial stitch begins by passing both needles from outside inward on the graft and from inside outward on the aorta. The suture is then tied. Figure 12, over and over suturing is then carried from the midline position, proceeding from outside the graft to inside the aorta at the midline anteriorly. This suture is again tied. Figure 13. Vascular clamps are temporarily applied to the iliac limbs of the graft, and the aortic clamp is momentarily released to check the proximal suture line for hemostasis and the pre-clotting of the graft should leaks be noted in the anastomosis. They can be controlled by individual mattress sutures. The iliac anastomoses are done in the same manner as that of the aorta. Figure 14. Just before completion of the anastomosis, the aortic clamp is opened momentarily to flush any clots that may have accumulated in the aorta or graft. Figure 15. This flushing out greatly lessens the incidence of subsequent thrombosis in either extremity and justifies a considerable loss of blood.